as part of the staff of urology.
De la Universidad de California, San Diego.
In San Diego, Cali University.
Dr. Armil going to speak advances in prostatectomía radical robótica.
Dr. Amir is going to talk about minimally invasive surgery and in oncology.
Should I start?
Dr. Amir, it's a pleasure.
Dr. Amir, it's a pleasure. Please move.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity. I'm presenting the advances in a robotic radical prostatectomy. To 85% in the US. And now the majority of cases are performed robotically. Despite several technical advancements of the during all these past two or three decades, still achievement of the good post-operative functional outcomes such as urinary incontinence and potency is still a challenge. For urinary incontinence, the 12-month urinary incontinence rate range from 4 to 31% in a mean value of 16%. If we use like a description of the NOPAD, if you know, considering of NOPAD or safety path definition, the incidence range from 8 to 11% with a mean of 9%. For potency, even with the nervous bearing, the erectile function, good erectile function, in 12 to 24 months, potency rates range between 54 to 90% and 63 to 94% in 12 months, 24 months. So what are the advancements with the technique? So there are multiple techniques are described for nervous bearing. So some of them are athermal dissection of the neurovascular bundle, using of the clips, high anterior dissection or release of the nerves, anterior approach, posterior approach. And there are also some other technology or devices that they reported in the literature, but we are not using that much, but there's a potential for them that we can use in the future. One of them is using a laser, CO2 laser, that causes like a very, you know, similar to the athermal dissection, and you can use this laser and it creates about the 40 degrees of Celsius temperature, and safely you can dissect the nerves without the damage them. There was a study with a good results around the 2010. The other way to do that, we call it neurosafe. That means that after we're removing the neurovascular bundle, so we dissect it from the prostate, we send the frozen section from the neurovascular area intra of the frozen section. There was a study that reported like a evaluated 5,000 patient that, you know, compared the neurosafe radical prostatectomy to the regular one, and they found that the frequency of the good nerve sparing significantly higher for all stages of cancer was a 97 versus 81%. For patients with the pathology T2, 99 versus 92%. Pathology T3A, 94 to 72, and T3B, 88 versus 40%, significantly improved your nerve sparing. And the only problem with this technique, it's very effective, but it needs like a multiple equipment and the staff in the OR to be available. You cut it, evaluate it in the microscope, and all this evaluation. So the other technology is like using another type of laser to same thing that creates like a very low heat with a shallow penetration that we can use for a nerve sparing. There's other study that, you know, suggested using some laparoscopic ultrasound to find your neurovascular bundle. There is a study that uses a transrectal ultrasound to characterize and, you know, find your neurovascular bundle. The other study that used the hyaluronic acid cellulose, that it puts a rapid around the neurovascular. And the reason behind that, that all this, some of the studies showed that the injury to the nerves are because of the post-operating inflammation, and then the by recruitment of the immune cells and the secretion of the inflammatory cytokines. And using of this adhesion barrier, we decrease the inflammation around the nerve neurovascular bundle. And the study used this in a 162 patient and compared it to the 287 that not using, that potency rate was at 28.5% versus 17.4% in 6 months. There's other studies used like a dehydrated human amniotic membrane allograft to wrap the nerves. The reason behind that, that this amniotic membrane secretes some cytokines that helps with the regeneration of the nerve. And if you see the bottom here, that use like this wrap around the nerves, that's amniotic wrap, you know, in the neurovascular. And the other technology is using of the ICG in the cyanine green, using an IV intraop, and that ICG binds to the albumin and goes to the vessels. And it's just going to have some fluorescence, your landmark artery on your, and you can recognize your border of your neurovascular bundle, and you can perform a better nerve sparing. So there are also some advancements, you know, during these 10 years for a preservation of the continence. Nerve sparing techniques. Nerve sparing techniques not only is good for potency, also suggests there are some studies show that also helps with the return of your continence. The data in this field is controversial, but overall, if you gather all the data, most data support the concept that good nerve sparing helps with the continence. Bladder neck preservation. Then in a randomized clinical trial that showed that the people have a that have a bladder neck preservation has a better continence rate at 3 months, 6 months, and 12 months. And if you cannot, you know, it's not possible to do a bladder neck preservation, we suggested do like a bladder neck reconstruction. And there's a study that compared different type of the bladder neck reconstruction, and all of them has a similar result. So it's highly recommended that if you can reconstruct it to the bladder neck, because the internal sphincter is in that the bladder neck area, and with the reconstruction, we can increase the support for internal sphincter. The most important factor for the return of your continence is a urethral lens preservation. In a study that opened prostatectomy, compared that the length, and they said the people that have a preserve until like a veromonitorium, they have a better continence than the people that have a less urethral length. So the way I do, I try to swab the prostate as much as possible out of the urethra before I cut my urethral margin. Periurethral suspension stitch. They started this idea from the Dr. Walsh, that you know he used to reverse his needle after the anastomosis to put in the symphysis pubis, and it showed using this suspension stitch, it helps with the return of the return of continence, but only at the short period of the time, at the 3 months. But the long term, there's no difference between these two groups. Posterior reconstruction of the Raptor sphincter or modified version of it is a Rocco stitch that you connected that Vinovia fascia. And then same thing, they show that have a short-term advantage. There is no benefit in the long-term follow. Combined anterior and posterior reconstruction, similar result. And there is lots of new studies and new debate right now about for anterior preservation, or call it residue sparing radical prostatectomy. The first Dr. Bucciardi described this technique in 2010. And the advantage of this technique is you can preserve all structure that you know anteriorly located, including the your endopelvic fascia, your DVC, your pubic prostatic ligament. And they showed in the prospective non-controlled cases of a 200 patient that who underwent the residue sparing, immediate continence was over the 90% of the patient. In this same study, in a selected patient of the younger with a good nervous sparing and had a even the erectile function was like good in the 40-70% in 1 month and 1 year. Other advantage of this technique is like a lower incidence of inguinal hernia, easier access in patient that already had a hernia repair or maintaining the virgin residue space. The concern is increase the rate of surgical positive margin, and also it's very is not an easy technique and is a little challenging with the you need like a good learning curve. So there's a study meta-analysis that compared that the residue space sparing to the conventional route, and that showed that when you compare them, the early continence is better in the residue space. 3 months with the low quality evidence is better, but at 6 months and 12 months is not. There's a similar results between two groups. And time to the continence recovery is much shorter in the people underwent to the residue space surgery, preserving surgery. Again, based on this meta-analysis, low quality evidence, there is no evidence that the people go underwent the residue spacing has a higher rate of the positive margins. And the short-term biochemical recurrence was similar to these two groups, and there is no overall change in overall survival between these two groups. There's other technology now is talk today about that is a single port radical prostatectomy. So robotic assisted less has advantage of the shorter recovery period, less post op pain, and improved cosmesis. However, it's very technically challenging surgery. With the new robotic platform called Da Vinci's SP surgical system that has a US FDA approval, there are multiple reports coming out that with a good outcome. This robot, they use an articulating camera and the instruments docked from the single laparoscopic trocar. Multiple studies showed it's safe, feasible approach for doing the single port radical prostatectomy and could potentially reduce post-op pain and morbidity. However, we need a randomized trial with the adequate sample size and long-term follow-up for better understand this technology. The other concept I want to talk about that is the same day discharge after the prostatectomy. That's lots of debate around that. There are multiple single center studies that show that implementation of the same day discharge is safe without increasing risk of any risk of complication. The cost analysis suggested a not negligible reduction in the charge per patient. Overall cost per patient decreased by 10% by same day discharge. There's a study that reported multi-institutional evaluation, and in this study, concomitant lymph node dissection and nerve sparing procedure was performed in the 43% and 62% of the cases. The same-day discharge failure, complication, and readmission was 4.2%, 16.8%, and 2.8%. The most frequent complication was low-grade complication like a urinary infection in 6.4% and ileus 2.8%.
5 minutes warning.
And then the predictors of the failure were the blood loss, intra-blood loss, lymph node dissection, and the post-op pain. So in conclusion, despite all these surgical improvements over the last three decades, significant improvement of the functional outcome of the patient undergoing the curative surgery for prostate cancer is still remain a challenge. Thank you. Ready for questions?
Any question? We don't have a question. Dr. Salami, what kind of technology do you use to nerve sparing? Do you use ICG, Firefly, or do you use another kind of technology like you shown?
I don't use any of them. I just use like a modified anterior and posterior approach and retrograde and antegrade approach. And I use like a high anterior release of my nerves. So I feel comfortable, you know, my training at UCLA and also I do all the cases I hear. I feel more comfortable to doing that. And I'm not using any of the ICG or other technology.
Do you use early release of the nerve sparing, the nerve, or do you use a posterior, like a new technique that Dr. Patel tell us about posterior?
Yes. So I start with the anterior to see where are my nerves. I do like a kind of like a modified combination. I start anterior, then I do go back to the posterior, and then they try to connect the dots.
Okay, excellent. Yo creo que podemos pasar al siguiente. Thank you, Dr. Salami. It's a pleasure.
Thank you. Thanks for the opportunity. It was a pleasure, my pleasure.
Dr. Michael Palazzi. Dr. Michael Palazzi is the chairman of the Hospital Mount Sinai Downtown Union Square in New York and professor of urology in Icahn School of Medicine, director of the program of fellowship in
minimally invasive surgery at Mount Sinai.
Director del programa de
fellowship de la cirugía for minimally invasive surgery.
Realizó su residencia en urología.
He did his residency program in urology
en la Universidad de Maryland.
In the University of Maryland.
Y posteriormente completó un fellowship
and
en la
then he
Nueva York.
Completed his fellowship in New York.
Presbyterian Hospital.
At the Presbyterian Hospital.
He's going to share us cirugía renal robótica, nefrectomía parcial y trasplante renal. Dr. Michael.
Uy. Okay, sorry, I'm trying to get.
Don't worry. Don't worry, it's a pleasure.
Do you all see my screen or no?
I see
it's your screen.
Terrific. Yes, we're good?
Perfect. It's good. Perfect.
Okay, great. Well, thank you so much for inviting me. For a nice introduction, yes, I'm from New York, and as all of you know, we were sort of the start of the pandemic for North America, which is now traveling to South America. And so it gives me great pleasure to sort of get used to these Zoom meetings as they've become very common. As you know, as a New Yorker, we like to talk fast, and so I'm going to do my best to be as slow as possible. So if I'm speaking faster than I should, please let me know. I have no disclosures except that I received a nice present during this COVID-19 episode. I just tested positive for IgG and IgM antibodies. And so that's one nice leftover thing from this whole COVID pandemic. We've actually started to get back to some normalcy in New York. Actually, today I was able to do 6 surgeries. We're almost back to getting elective surgery. But I think the important thing as urologists, especially as robotic and laparoscopic surgeons, is important for us to understand that COVID will definitely change the way that we practice. So I want to kind of mention some of these things, some of the tactical measures that are coming out from some of our societies, including the Society for Laparoscopic Surgery, the AUA, the Endourology Society. So, you know, there's a concern that the smoke that we create during laparoscopy or robotic surgery can hold COVID, or that we are dispersing COVID with some of the CO2 gas. Most of the studies don't indicate that that's really what's happening, because most of the COVID, the viral load, is really in the respiratory system. But some of the points that have come up is that we should make sure that we use very, very small ports and very small incisions for our ports, not allowing any gas to escape around those ports. That we do the CO2 insufflation, we should really keep that at a minimum. Try to do your cases between 10 and 12 millimeters of mercury. Ideally, if you can have some kind of a smoke evacuator system, such as AirSeal or one of these other systems that evacuate the smoke, this would be helpful. And clearly, when you deflate and inflate, we should also be careful about not exposing any of the gas into the room. By that same token, I think the biggest risk for you as a surgeon and for your staff is during the intubation and extubation. And so we have a protocol in New York that if you are operating on a COVID positive patient, or any patient for that matter at all, everyone steps out of the room. The anesthesiologist and or his or her assistant will help to place the intubation, and same with the extubation. And this way we minimize the amount of dispersion of potential COVID respiratory droplets possible. So the other thing that we do now is that every patient that we operate on always gets a COVID test within 48 hours. That means if you're getting surgery on Monday or Tuesday, you're doing your test on Saturday or Sunday at the absolute earliest. Okay, and so these are things that have changed now over the last, literally in the last 6 weeks. I suspect that most of the world will sort of have to follow suit when it comes to surgery, and particularly when we talk about robotic and laparoscopic surgery. So Today, I'm going to speak a little bit about some of the trends in robotic surgery, some of those applications in renal surgery. We'll touch upon Singapore because we already have a presentation to follow mine. And I'm really going to focus more on some of the future robotic platforms, some of the things that are coming out in this year and next year that are going to be competitors to Intuitive Surgical and some of the other robotic companies. As we all know, robotic surgery has been around for well over 20 years. Renal surgery sort of came in its own in approximately 2006, 2008, mostly when the SI robot came into existence, and that was about 2009, is when we started to do more and more renal surgery. So renal surgery, when it first came out, the question was whether or not it was here to stay, and I think that over the last 10 years, we've certainly seen that robotic renal surgery has become the mainstay. Certainly in the United States, it's become the standard of care for many procedures. The uptake of robotic surgery has been relatively dramatic, not just in urology, but in all the disciplines such as orthopedics, ENT, cardiothoracic surgery. I'm not talking just about Intuitive Surgical, but other areas or other companies as well. The number of robotic procedures that have been performed in the United States has almost become sixfold in the last 10 years. And it's a $4 billion market right now. So actually, you know, quite large. We also have the trends of what's happening. So in the United States, in particular, certain procedures are becoming the standard of care, as I said. Partial nephrectomy became the standard of care in the United States in 2010. We're actually now seeing the same thing for radical nephrectomy. In 2015, we saw the first time that more robotic nephrectomies were being done than laparoscopic nephrectomies. Open surgery is still prevalent in when it comes to radical nephrectomy, but I suspect over the next 5 to 10 years, we'll continue to see a trend where robotic surgery will overtake that as well. The amount of systems in the United States or the amount of hospitals that have five or more systems has also dramatically gone up in the last 5 years. We've seen approximately a 400% growth in those types of hospitals. My facility at Mount Sinai, we have over 20 robots currently in our system. We have 11 in our main hospital, two single port systems as well. Each of the smaller hospitals have at least one or two robots as well. So it's becoming, like I said, very much the standard of care. One thing that, of course, you have to worry about is when you have a robot, people are going to use it, and we've shown and that if you're we'll, of course, use it more often. And so that may add to costs over time, but there's a lot of controversy about that, and that would be a whole other lecture for now. So how do we use robotic surgery? Well, one of the things that we were concerned about was when we introduced robotic surgery for renal surgery, in particular for partial nephrectomy, was how do we impart and make sure that our surgeons are actually doing the procedure properly. So one of the things that we did in the very beginning was to look at our experience of laparoscopic surgery versus robotic surgery, and we found actually that experienced laparoscopic surgeons were able to pick up robotic surgery relatively quickly. Within 5 to 20 cases, most laparoscopic surgeons, especially the experienced ones, really were able to get numbers that were very close to their laparoscopic experience. And so that's a good thing. So it shows that we can certainly make that jump very easily for most procedures. And in fact, I think as time goes on, as the technology becomes cheaper, we'll see more and more people take this up, not only in the United States, but everywhere else. So the most common procedures that we do, of course, partial nephrectomy, radical nephrectomy, simple nephrectomy, pyeloplasty, ureteral reconstruction has absolutely become standard of care to do this robotically. But the one area that is still lacking, where we really are still doing most of these laparoscopically, is in donor and or recipient renal transplant. And of course, the recipient side is most of those are still being done open. And so this is one area where I think we still have a lot to learn and a lot to push forward when it comes to robotic surgery. We started a robotic donor nephrectomy program in 2017. We looked very closely at some of the differences between doing robotic versus laparoscopic donor nephrectomy, and we found very simply that there are some advantages to doing robotically. We found that there was improved hilar dissection with longer vascular length. We were able to find that anywhere between 3 and 5 millimeters longer if we did it robotically versus when we did it laparoscopically. We were able to preserve ureteral tissue, and in fact found that when we looked long-term, there were fewer ureteral strictures in patients that had robotic surgery than those that underwent laparoscopic surgery. Patients also tended to have lower pain scores. We felt that our younger surgeons were having faster learning curves to learn how to do the procedure, and obviously better surgical ergonomics. So the surgeon was certainly had an easier time doing the operation. The disadvantages, of course, included kidney recovery time was a little bit more difficult, a little more time consuming. You needed someone at the bedside to help, usually a fellow or a second attending. We had longer ischemia time, longer extraction time, and certainly higher cost is something that we have to worry about. How about the flip side, the recipient side? Well, the first robotic-assisted kidney transplant was done in 2002. This was really just to sew the anastomosis. By 2010, the first purely robotic-assisted kidney transplant was performed. It was found that most of the time, this is really useful just for obese patients. Different techniques were used, including extra and transperitoneal techniques. The graft was either inserted most commonly in abdominally, but could also be transvaginally. And where it was very helpful, of course, was during the vascular anastomosis, where there was the artery, the vein, and the ureteral anastomosis. The largest cohort of robotic kidney transplants comes from Europe. This is a paper published in 2018 from a multi-center trial of looking at 120 patients, where they looked at the feasibility and how well patients did. In general, the warm ischemia time, the cold ischemia time, the rewarming time, these are all very acceptable and very similar to open surgery. The complication rates were also relatively similar to open surgery, with grade 3A and grade 3B complications being acceptable, where, of course, arterial thrombosis and bleeding being the worst complications was discovered or was equal to what is done in open surgery. Dr. Kook was one of the first to perform a single port kidney transplant. He did this earlier this year. It's very bold of him, since the technology really just became FDA approved approximately 6 months ago. So he didn't waste his time. And so he actually has a very nice video online that you can look at. And obviously, in the interest of time, I didn't include that. So single port, I'm just going to mention very briefly. This is of course going to revolutionize many of our procedures. There are still some major disadvantages. Certainly, that some of the technological advances for doing them for multiports, the stapler, our Firefly, these are all things that are not in there. And I'm sure my colleague will go into more detail in regards to that. The cosmesis has been touted as sort of one of the major improvements when you do a single port. The jury is still out about that. The incision you have to make is at least 2.6 centimeters. And so sometimes arguing leaving a 2.6 centimeter incision versus a multi-port of 3 or 4 8-millimeter incisions, which one is really makes a difference clinically, it still needs to be decided. And again, this is going to take some time, and we're going to have to also do some head-to-head studies. We were just about to present at the AUA, American Urologic Association, this year in Washington, D.C., some of our practical tips and tricks for successful single-port robotic partial nephrectomy. We have one of the larger series of over 35 cases that basically we've done since November. Obviously, COVID has stifled our ability to do these cases, but we hope to get back to doing them very shortly. And we actually have a very nice video also that we submitted to the AUA this year that you can also access to see our experience. How about some future robotic platforms? So I think one of the things that we always have to worry about is that Intuitive Surgical has really had a corner on the market for many years. They've driven the costs up. They've made it almost impossible for any other company to come in. This particular company called Transenterix tried very hard to get another robot in to the United States earlier this year. They sold about 4 or 5 units, and then Intuitive Surgical came in and made it very difficult for them to continue. This uses 3D glasses. There's an eye tracking system, so when you move your eyes, the system actually moves with you, and so it's kind of exciting technology. The difference here also that you had individual carts that you put on the outside of the table. But like I said, unfortunately, it doesn't look like this company is going to survive. Their stock has dropped dramatically, and certainly during this COVID pandemic, I'm assuming that their money is going to start to run out. another competitor called Versius. This is a United Kingdom. Also, they're using 3D glasses. They're using five lightweight, individually mounted robotic arms. These are meant to be more lightweight, more flexible. They have haptic feedback, so you can feel the tissue when you're moving. This is one thing that Intuitive has always been sort of had a quote unquote disadvantage, because you can't feel the tissue. And it's supposed to leave a very small footprint and will come out in Europe, I think, later this year. One of the more exciting companies that's now gotten into the robot game is Medtronic. As most of you know, Medtronic is a huge multi-billion-dollar company. They're trying to design a lower-cost robot, also using 3D HD technology. It has a motion-compensating technology that allows you to operate. So, for instance, on a beating heart or in some kind of moving tissue, it should allow you to operate and will compensate for that. And so, obviously, when this comes out, I think this will be exciting to see. They're still very early. I think they're several years away from coming out. They've been buying up smaller digital companies to get some of the technology to come in. The one company that I think is the most exciting is the Verb Surgery, and this is a joint venture between Google and Johnson & Johnson Epicon. What we're doing here is, what the company is doing here is trying to make a true telesurgery, telemedicine type of company, where they're going to use very lightweight robot arms that have auditory, visual, tactile feedback, motion compensation, a very small footprint, so you can use this in any operating room anywhere. And most likely, as a surgeon, you'll be able to operate anywhere in the world and use this technology. And that's their goal. And I think this is probably the one company, they have enough dollars to take on Intuitive Surgical. And so we probably will be hearing from them very soon. But they're also very much in their early stages as well. Besides the actual robots, the automation has become very popular. We're starting to see robots that are now being integrated into the OR as assistants, as opposed to the actual surgical operators. In particular, this is an exciting one called Gesto Nurse. This is a scrub nurse. So as you operate, the scrub nurse actually hands you the scalpel, hands you the retractor. And so I gave a lecture to some of the technologists and nursing assistants in the operating room, and they were very worried about this technology. But it's a reality. I think that some points this could make sense, especially for minor procedures. Why pay a full-time nurse to come in and hand you instruments when there's a robot that can certainly do that? There are robots now that are also doing autonomous surgery. This one in particular is called the STAR system. It's actually what it will do, will suture soft tissue such as bowel. This is sort of also an exciting technology. It's all very much in its infancy as well. But the idea that we push a button and then the computer or the robot will do the surgery for us. One of the last things I want to show here.
The first subtask is linear debris.
Actually showing the robot itself. So in this case, it's Intuitive Surgical's robot. We've taught it how to do linear debridement. So basically, you think about it, someone needs to go back to the operating room for recurrent eschar resection, or a burn victim who has to come back and get a washout. We're teaching the robots how to identify sort of dead tissue, necrotic tissue, and the robot can certainly debride. And I think that this is real, this is already being used, and I think we potentially will see this very shortly. So with that, I think I'm almost done with my time here. I'm just going to show you all so what happens in New York around 7 p.m. every night. We adopted this from our Italian friends. At 7 p.m. every evening, we have our entire New York City comes alive. Pan, chopping pan, bongos, everyone's out there, honking horns. And so this is one nice thing about being in New York City's last 8 weeks, besides the fact that everything's closed. This is one thing I always look forward to every evening. So with that, I want to say thank you very much, and I'll take any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Pallas. Okay, we don't have any question, but it's very interesting, your presentation. I have a little question over here. What kind in the in-person nephrectomy do you use any ICG or any kind of dyeing for the take better the border of the
tumor? ICG, I've used ICG in various forms. So when it first came out, we used it quite a bit for tumor identification. And then we found that it didn't work quite as well as we wanted. I found that it actually was better for instance, ureteral stricture disease and for reconstructive purposes rather than for tumor or oncologic purposes. There have been some new reports about using different doses that might be helpful. But honestly, I'm not sure clinically it really translates into a good use of the technology. It's much better, like I said, for strictures and for reconstructive purposes.
Very good. Thank you, Dr. Pallese.
Thanks so much.
We have another presentation, Dr. Garisto. Bueno, Juan, ya te vi temprano en la presentación. Es un orgullo, Juan, para todos
Juan,
nosotros.
Juan, I saw you earlier in the presentation, and we're very proud as Panamanians to have you here with us today.
¿Me escuchan?
Que estés aquí con nosotros.
¿Me escuchan? Hello?
Sí, doctor, lo escuchamos bien.
Oh, gracias.
Creo que el doctor Boden se le cayó la señal de...
I think Dr. Boden lost his internet signal. He looks a little okay. Frozen.
Si me permiten, no sé...
So if you allow me, Dr. Fuya, could you please introduce Dr. Garisto?
Oh, gracias.
Completó una beca en la Sociedad de Oncología Urológica por 2 años en la Universidad de Toronto. Posteriormente realizó un entrenamiento clínico adicional con
He did his additional
beca.
Clinical training with a second scholarship in minimally invasive surgery during a 2-year period at the Cleveland Clinic in Ohio.
Un periodo de 2 años en Cleveland Clinic.
Gracias.
Juan nos va a brindar la conferencia Cirugía Robótica por Puerto Único, aplicaciones actuales y sus resultados. Bienvenido, Juan.
Robotic surgery.
Gracias, doctor Boden. A ver. Sí. ¿Me ven aquí?
Sí, perfecto, Juan.
Okay. Bueno, ante todo, buenas noches, muchas gracias
to begin,
al comité
good evening.
Organizador,
thank
al,
you to the
doctor
organizing
Fajardo,
committee,
Juan Puya,
Dr. Fajardo, Dr.
Fuya, a la Sociedad de América Urológica Centroamericana, al Dr. Boden.
Central American
bueno, el día
Urological
de hoy,
Association and Dr. Boden. Thank you so much for the invitation. Today I'm going to present the experience that I've had
con
through
el robot
the Cleveland Clinic
el
with
the
single port robot.
The
title, as you can see, is the current status
for
state-of-the-art of the urological surgery with a robotic
básicamente, como ustedes saben,
with a single
port.
As you know,
a través del tiempo de
there has been an evolution over time
urológica,
with surgical
empezando con la cirugía abierta, que es una
surgery,
cirugía tradicional
with open
y vigente.
Surgery, which is a
obviamente una
amplia and very
gama
current
de
surgery, it offers a broad
embargo,
range of
requiere,
applications, but it also
mayor
requires
a
certain level of recovery time and hospital stay.
A través del tiempo, esta evolución
over time,
ha traído a la cirugía mínimamente invasiva. Recordemos el doctor Ralph Kleiman en el año 91
Dr.
cuando publicó en el Journal of Urology la
neurología
radical laparoscópica y a través del tiempo bueno
prostatectomy and over time it's grown exponentially
en donde muchos artículos hacen referencia a la reducción del tiempo hospitalario y evidentemente
reduction
la
in hospital
riesgo,
stay, reducing risk,
durante el
and adverse
quirúrgico.
Events during
ya sabemos
the surgical
que,
procedure. And we also
en el
know
2000,
that in 2000,
la FDA, aquí en
the
Unidos,
FDA in the United States
aprobó el primer,
approved
el robot
the first robot,
como
robot S,
un, device
that has been used over time.
Y evidentemente
ha
existido una exponencial
desarrollo
del mismo y la
exponential development of this in
y por último, bueno,
well.
La FDA también
last,
recientemente
least,
en mayo de 2008 aprobó el DaVinci SP, es el acrónimo en inglés del single port o robot de puerto único y es el que vamos a hablar actualmente. Como tal, este fue el primer artículo que
as
me
such,
trajo
so this
a referencia
a
un artículo que nosotros publicamos en la European Urology en base
published
con la Mayo Clinic Y es una, la evolución sistemática de la cirugía robótica de Puerto Rico. El primer reporte de casos fue en el año 2008 por el doctor Cayuc en el DIU, en donde se reportaban tres procedimientos urológicos. Y posteriormente esto continuó en el año 2014 cuando existió el reporte del primer robot SP99, que es la primera versión de la actual single port, en donde se publicaron en aquel entonces... junto con el doctor Arnold Villers en Francia, 19 casos de procedimientos mayores urológicos. Y bueno, a través de los últimos años, del 2014 a la fecha, evidentemente ha existido una preparación con estudios preclínicos para que hoy en día se utilice en humanos el single port. Como estudios preclínicos y preparación, bueno, este es un artículo que publicamos en el Urology haciendo una descripción de la experiencia clínica utilizando el SP-98. Y este es el prototipo inicial, inicial del segundo robot que actualmente tenemos. Y bueno, a través del tiempo realizamos diversos tipos de procedimientos en la clínica, iniciando con... Matthew Maris, que es el previo fellow del doctor Cayuc, realiza una nefrectomía parcial con arboraje retroperitoneal. Un paper que se publicó en el European Urology en Urology Motion. Después vino Danny Ramirez publicando la prostatectomía perineal robótica. Posteriormente, Matthew nuevamente publicó la descripción de la técnica de la prostatectomía perineal utilizando el single port. Posteriormente vino la nueva generación de fellows, en este caso se describió y se desarrolló la técnica de la diversión urinaria intracorpórea perineal y por último el doctor Cayuc y mi persona publicamos en el la prostatectomía parcial transvesical. Todos estos fueron estudios preliminares y de preparación para utilizar el single.
And pre-studies
este es un paper que publicamos acerca de cómo la técnica de cómo se hace el docking y aquí hago la descripción del mismo del device como tal del robot, es un robot de un solo brazo, tiene la particularidad que puede rotar aproximadamente 180 grados sobre un boom que lo hace bastante interesante para de alguna u otra forma alinearse con los diversos órganos. Existe una distancia aproximadamente de 10 a 20 centímetros del robot a el órgano que se va a estar utilizando. El robot como tal tiene diversas formas de hacer de colocarse. Evidentemente existe una cánula que se coloca dentro del paciente, que es una cánula de aproximadamente 10 centímetros por 2.5 centímetros que tiene un obturador. Posteriormente, una vez se ha colocado dentro del paciente, se hace el cambio a esta guía de entrada, una cánula de guía de entrada que tiene cuatro orificios. Donde se colocarán posteriormente los instrumentos a utilizar. El docking, bueno, evidentemente pueden haber, el robot tiene un solo brazo, aquí realizamos el estudio de la prostatectomía parcial y hacíamos el docking, hacemos una vez introducido la cánula, hacemos el enganche directamente con el robot y posteriormente colocamos obviamente los instrumentos. Como ven, tiene cuatro orificios la cánula, uno para la cámara, el instrumento número uno que usualmente utilizamos, las tijeras, el Progress y posteriormente el Maryland. Estos son los diversos instrumentos que la Intuitive ha realizado para la utilización del mismo. Y como pueden ver también, la cámara es una cámara de 0 grados que el cirujano de consola puede libremente manejar.
And it can be freely managed.
Entonces, después de obviamente realizar esta preparación de 4 años de diversos tipos de procedimientos, empezamos con la experiencia clínica. Y la primera experiencia clínica lo publicamos en el European Urology. Es un estudio prospectivo observacional en donde se tomaron los datos de los primeros 9 pacientes donde se realizaron procedimientos urológicos dentro de los primeros 10 días posteriores a la instalación del dispositivo en la clínica. El objetivo primario fue determinar la seguridad y factibilidad de los procedimientos urológicos mayores en humanos.
Security and feasibility of the urological procedures in humans. And then we also, as we experienced, three transperitoneal prostatectomies, partial nephrectomy, simple cystectomy, and a cystectomy, simple cystectomy, and I'm going to talk about these now.
Entonces, como diversos procedimientos, está este fue el primer caso que realizamos en septiembre 28 del 2018, en donde fue el primer caso en Estados Unidos de una prostatectomía radical transperitoneal, y como pueden ver, voy a correr el video.
And I'm going to show you the video. We're going to have an incision of more or less 2.5 centimeters above
belly bottom, del ombligo, the belly button. Se coloca lo que es un gel point,
and we place a gel
point.
We already have a transperitoneal cavity open. And then we do the docking of the robot. The patient is placed.
Posteriormente se replican los mismos pasos de una prostatectomía radical multipuerto
radical multi-port prostatectomy.
Como mencioné, fueron dos casos transperitoneales. No existieron complicaciones operatorias, no existieron tasas de conversión a robot multipuerto o cirugía abierta. El tiempo operatorio average fue de 140 minutos. Existió una pérdida sanguínea mínima, y bueno, los pacientes fueron egresados en menos de 24 horas postoperatorias.
Allowed to leave the hospital 24 hours post-surgery. As you can see here, we are doing an anastomosis in here.
La incisión que realizamos es más o menos 2.5 centímetros. Al inicial se colocó un drenaje, y bueno, este es el espécimen. Posteriormente, cambiamos un poco la técnica, y en aquel entonces realizamos los primeros 10 casos en un estudio prospectivo observacional, y publicamos de la prostatectomía robótica de cuarto único con un abordaje extraperitoneal. A través del tiempo, se ha ido haciendo modificaciones a la técnica.
We have been making modifications to the technique. However, everyone knows how we do this extraperitoneal approach when we have 2.5 centimeter incisions below the belly button. We develop a
space where we place a balloon. And the balloon desarrolla el espacio se colocando posteriormente el laparoscopio posteriormente
con seguridad,
y posteriormente de eso se pasa directamente a hacer la colocación del gel point junto con el trocar. Evidentemente la anatomía es un poco diferente, sin embargo el procedimiento como tal replica directamente los mismos pasos que se realizan durante una prostatectomía radical multipuerto transperitoneal.
That has multi ports and is
transperitoneal. En decúbito totalmente supino sin colocarle sin estar en
trendelenburg.
Este es otro paper que publicamos en el World Journal of Urology acerca de la prostatectomía perineal y la evolución a través del tiempo, y este es en base a la prostatectomía perineal utilizando el abordaje abierto pero al mismo tiempo el abordaje robótico, una animación más o menos para que este procedimiento como tal lo hemos utilizado en aproximadamente unos 30 pacientes. Y son pacientes que han tenido previas cirugías, tienen abdómenes complejos, son abdómenes con previas resecciones abdominoperineales, previas radiaciones, tenemos pacientes con enfermedad de Crohn, con índice de masa corporal de más o menos 50, que evidentemente previa de radiación, y evidentemente no, la última procedimiento o manejo que se le puede dar para la adquisición del tumor y de la próstata.
Best management that we can do for the prostate.
Entonces, la explicación del mismo, el paciente se coloca en posición de litotomía, se hace una incisión a nivel perineal de más o menos 2.5 centímetros. El abordaje que realizamos, abordaje tipo Bell, en donde vamos paralelo directamente al recto. Y una vez hacemos el espacio, posterior a eso, colocamos el anillo y el gel point. Vamos a observar aquí donde va a existir la colocación del single port y también el paciente colocamos el robot entre las piernas del paciente. Este es el setup, el asistente va a estar en medio del paciente y el cirujano de consola va a estar obviamente en la consola. Y bueno, aquí replicamos lo mismo que se realiza en una prostatectomía perineal abierta. Realizamos el desarrollo del espacio perirectal, posteriormente la disección de las vesículas seminales, hacemos la disección posteriormente de los lóbulos laterales de la próstata. Una vez que hemos liberado los lóbulos laterales de la próstata, vamos a observar directamente la uretra, hacemos la disección de la uretra, retiramos el catéter y posteriormente hacemos la disección del cuello vesical. Importante destacar que también realizamos linfadenectomías pélvicas en estos pacientes y posteriormente al final obviamente la anastomosis uretrovesical. Estos son los resultados, básicamente una incisión de más o menos 3 centímetros y el espécimen a continuación.
And this is our specimen.
Otro de los procedimientos que hemos hecho son prostatectomías simples con abordaje transmesical. Se hace una colocación directamente del single port directamente sobre dentro de la vejiga. Se hace un neumovésico y posteriormente se hacen los mismos pasos replicados de una prostatectomía. Aquí vemos el cistoscopio donde existe una visión donde se puede ver la cámara y los tres instrumentos dentro de la vejiga. Y bueno, se hace la adenomectomía como existe en la descripción técnica.
As we see in the technical description.
Y posteriormente podemos ver los resultados que hemos tenido en estos 10 primeros pacientes, aunado a la incisión, la pequeña incisión y el espécimen.
And the specimen as such.
En cuanto a cirugía renal, hemos hecho los dos tipos de abordajes, los abordajes transperitoneales y retroperitoneales. Les voy a enseñar el paper que publicamos en el Urology acerca de los tres primeros casos transperitoneales. La misma posición es una posición de cúbito lateral, hacemos una incisión de 2.5 centímetros, entramos a la cavidad peritoneal y posteriormente colocamos un gel point de 10 centímetros, colocamos el trocar, utilizamos un AirSeal y posteriormente hacemos el docking del robot. El procedimiento como tal es un procedimiento que replica directamente nuevamente los mismos principios quirúrgicos de la nefrectomía parcial de multipuerto. Evidentemente, en este artículo que publicamos no hubieron complicaciones intraoperatorias, no existió una tasa de conversión a cirugía robótica multipuerto o cirugía abierta. El tiempo operatorio averaje más o menos fue de 180 minutos, el tiempo de isquemia fue de 25 minutos, la pérdida sanguínea aproximadamente 180 cc. Es importante destacar que en los 30 primeros días postoperatorio únicamente existió en un paciente se tuvo que realizar una angioembolización que recae sobre una complicación clavia en treja. Vemos aquí cómo se está haciendo la excisión del tumor y posteriormente la cranografía del mismo. Se lo coloca el endocatchback y se observa el hecho quirúrgico, que no haya ningún tipo de sangrado, y posteriormente vamos a observar los resultados. Estamos haciendo la extracción del espécimen. Y bueno, estos son los resultados postoperatorios con una sección periumbilical que se esconde dentro del ombligo.
within the
dentro de cirugía reconstructiva, bueno, por situaciones de tiempo, traje este que es un artículo que publicamos al BJU acerca de los tres primeros casos transperitoneales que realizamos, y en este caso se coloca el puerto más o menos 5 centímetros del ombligo y se coloca un puerto
asistente.
Y bueno, en este paciente en particular es un paciente que tenía un epivertículo vesical aunado con una litiasis vesical, así que la indicación quirúrgica fue realizarle una diverticulectomía y como tal hacemos inicialmente la movilización de la vejiga, luego hacemos la transiluminación con el residente haciendo la transiluminación con un cistoscopio flexible, hacemos la excisión del divertículo como tal, vamos a observarla en el cistoscopio junto con la litiasis vesical. A continuación aquí y posteriormente, una vez que se ha hecho la diverticulectomía, pasamos a cerrar la vejiga y a continuación hacer el reimplante ureteral. Una vez colocado el stent, se hace una anastomosis tipo
Lich-Gregois
y finalizamos. Estos son los resultados posteriores de una incisión de 2.5 centímetros y bueno, en algunos casos lo podemos hacer pure single port y otros casos colocamos un puerto adicional. En cuanto a cirugía vesical, voy a resumirles la primera cistectomía radical que realizamos. Hicimos dos casos masculinos, dos casos femeninos. Con pacientes que tenían, evidentemente PT2 con carcinoma urotelial de alto grado y que habían recibido quimioterapia. En este caso, lo importante es destacar aquí, una vez hicimos la incisión de más o menos a 5 centímetros del ombligo, colocamos este puerto, que va a ser el AirSeal, pero lo importante es destacar que es el mismo puerto que vamos a utilizar en un futuro para la creación del estoma, donde colocaremos el endo GIA y al mismo tiempo, vamos a crear el estoma como tal.
We're going to create a stoma.
Ponemos el paciente en Trendelenburg, hacemos el docking del robot y replicamos los mismos pasos de una cirugía robótica multipuerto donde existe la disección del uréter, de la división del mismo, hacemos los frozen sections, hacemos la disección contralateral, la disección la pared anterior del recto con la vejiga, posteriormente realizamos el desarrollo del espacio de Retzius, hacemos la disección de la fascia endopélvica, el asistente nos coloca los clips, los mímolos, para hacer la división de los vehículos vasculares, la ligación del complejo venoso dorsal, y bueno, posteriormente se hace la resección de la vejiga y la colocación del espécimen en un endocashback. En cuanto a la excentración pélvica, los mismos pasos, sin embargo, la anatomía es un poco diferente.
Pelvic,
evidentemente, lo primero es identificar las estructuras
adyacentes.
Hacemos la ligación de los ligamentos redondos, la división del ureter, el lado izquierdo y el contralateral. Posteriormente, colocamos una esponja en la vagina, identificamos el surco y abrimos la vagina. Hacemos el control de los vehículos vasculares, hacemos la división de la uretra y el asistente posteriormente coloca una pinza de aro a través de la vagina y hace la extracción del espécimen y la resección anterior de la uretra. Se cierra la vagina y se deja para la colocación de un puerto de 12 milímetros que se utilizará posteriormente para la derivación intracorpórea. Estos son los resultados, como pueden ver, nada más una pequeña incisión de más o menos 2.5-3 centímetros con la colocación del drenaje, el estoma ya madurado,
The stoma has
por situaciones de tiempo, nada más le venía y le quería mencionar acerca de derivación intracorpórea, también la realizamos y si en un futuro desean les puedo mandar el link para observar el video como tal. Y bueno, estos son, este es otro paper que publicamos con los primeros 100, la experiencia de los 100 primeros casos, de septiembre del 2008 a agosto del 2019. Como podemos observar, hemos realizado procedimientos retroperitoneales, pélvicos,
86 pelvic.
Hemos tenido complicaciones, sí, pero han sido mínimas, como pueden observar, seis complicaciones clave en 3A y tres clave en 2. Y bueno, estos son los resultados patológicos de los diversos procedimientos que se han conformado dentro de este primer año posterior a la instalación del single port. Como pueden ver, la conclusión, esta plataforma de puerto único puede ser incorporada de forma segura al armamentario urológico actualmente.
In the urological surgery platform.
Y bueno, para finalizar, sí, mis conclusiones, los procedimientos urológicos son factibles y seguros utilizando esta plataforma. Existen muchos estudios actuales, pero desafortunadamente son series de casos y estudios retrospectivos. Y en un futuro, evidentemente, deseamos y vamos a realizar estudios randomizado entre las tres tipos de cirugía, como mencioné al principio, la cirugía abierta, la cirugía robótica multipuerto y el puerto único, para establecer en realidad el valor de esta tecnología a continuación. Muchas gracias.
In the future. Thank you very much.
Muchas gracias, Juan. Excelente.
Thank you very much, Juan. Excellent presentation.
Gracias.
Of what is being done in your country. We have a few questions. It says the learning curve of this technology. What is the conversion to multi-port, and do you have a multi-port conversion? And do you think it's going, the SP is going to replace multi-port? And what do you think of the strength of the SP arm?
Bueno, gracias. Bastantes preguntas, pero me gusta que hagan preguntas.
Oh, that's a multiple question.
En cuanto a la curva de aprendizaje, no existe un paper actualmente que determine cuántos casos se deben realizar. Sin embargo, estamos trabajando en eso. Sí existe una curva de aprendizaje. Cuando yo estuve haciendo, utilizando las consolas multipuertos y se utiliza la consola de SP, existe diversos tipos de configuraciones que se deben tener dentro de la perspectiva del cirujano para el movimiento de los brazos robóticos. Así que sí existe una curva. Sin embargo, como nuestra experiencia ha radicado en los 100 primeros casos y evidentemente cada caso es diferente, cada tipo de procedimiento es diferente, estamos en futuro analizando las diversas curvas para los diversos procedimientos urológicos como tal. Importante destacar, existe también una curva para lo que es el docking and port placement en estos pacientes, porque se tiene que tomar en cuenta las diversas cirugías que tienen los pacientes previamente y las diversas composiciones o diferencias anatómicas que existen. La segunda pregunta era, doctor,
¿cree que reemplazará el
SP will replace
bueno,
multi-port.
Yo honestamente creo que la tecnología se debe utilizar en diversos tipos de procedimientos. Yo sí pienso de que en cuestiones de cirugía reconstructiva, llámese reimplante lateral, bioplastía, la cirugía de puerto único sí tiene un lugar. Sin embargo, existen casos. No podemos colocar ahorita mismo, por lo menos, realizar un single port en un tumor de 10 centímetros, porque existen ciertas desventajas en base a la técnica que se va a utilizar para la resección de un tumor, por ejemplo, de una mastectomía parcial. Si usted me pregunta si se va a reemplazar,
yo espero tener en un futuro
esa respuesta. Le puedo también contestar de que recientemente, hace dos semanas atrás, se publicó en un estudio comparativo entre el single port y el robot multipuerto, exactamente para prostatectomía radical transperitoneal. Lo publicó la Universidad de Illinois en Chicago, el grupo del doctor Crivellaro, y bueno, se encontró dos cosas importantes dentro de este estudio retrospectivo. Evidentemente, uno fue en cuanto a la disminución del umbral del dolor en los pacientes que se había realizado un single port, se hubiera utilizado la plataforma tipo single port, y la segunda cosa fue la disminución del tiempo de estancia intrahospitalaria en los pacientes de un día a dos comparado con el robot multipuerto. Así que sí, puede existir para ciertos procedimientos urológicos como tal un avance del single port y ciertas ventajas. ¿Cuál era la tercera pregunta?
Acerca de la fuerza.
The strength
sí,
of the robot.
Esa es una de las pequeñas desventajas. Los instrumentos nosotros utilizamos tres instrumentos y la cámara. La cámara más o menos es de 12 milímetros por 10 milímetros, el instrumento es 6 milímetros. En la parte, en el tip, la parte distal, la punta del instrumento, por ejemplo, cuando se hace la renografía, la técnica de la renografía colocando los clips, no tiene la misma fuerza que un robot, un STI o un XI. Y esa es la diferencia por la cual escoger exactamente el tipo de procedimiento, de ya sea una nefrectomía parcial de 2 o 3 centímetros o 4 centímetros, a diferencia de tener una nefrectomía parcial de 10 centímetros. Yo en lo particular, y el grupo de la Cleveland Clinic obviamente se inclinaría un poco más hacia un robot multipuerto a un robot single port. Así que sí, existe una deficiencia, pienso yo, y espero en un futuro observar la segunda versión, así como existió el STI y posteriormente salió el y con ciertos avances, espero yo observar las ventajas que tenga la segunda versión del single port.
This progress or these versions in the future. Excellent, Juan. Thank you very much for all Panama. Obviously, they're quite proud of you and quite proud of the progress you've made.
Quiero invitar al siguiente simposio, que va a ser el próximo jueves.
I would like to invite you to our next symposium, which is going to be next Thursday. Lathias's nephrectomy, and I would like to invite next Monday at 6 p.m. In Panama, sponsored by the Philadelphia University. We're going to have Dr. Daniel. You saw him in some of Juan's articles. He's going to be sharing reconstructive robotic surgery in the upper urinary tract. So I'm going to send you the links for Monday. And for all AUCA and for all of our brothers and sisters in Latin America to join us on Thursday.
Para el próximo jueves tenemos láser en endourología.
We'll have lasers in endourology, review of lithotripters, intracorporeal lithotripters in endourology, and new progress in urethroscopy, flexible urethroscopy, and urethroscopes or disposable urethroscopes. So thanks to all the speakers. Thanks for being with us. Thanks for everyone. Can you hear me? Yes. So I'd like to thank all the speakers, Dr. Salmasi, Dr. Palazzi, Dr. Garisto. For those of us who are participating in Module 1, we're pretty surprised and pretty amazed by everything that can be done with technology, how technology has made progress. Dr. Garisto, Dr. Palazzi, and Dr. Salmasi, thank you very much. I would also like to thank Dr. Elias Bowden for his excellent moderation, and reiterate to all of you who are seeing us from different countries an invitation for the second module next Thursday, like Dr. Elias said. The first module, we're going to have another. And greetings to all of our friends on the continent. Thank you very much. Thank you for participating in our first course. I think I can't thank you enough. Our speakers, you definitely taught us what is state of the art in robotics. So thank you very much, and we'll see you next week. Thank you very much. Goodbye, and thanks to everyone.
Gracias, gracias, doctor.
Hello, Juan. Un placer.
Gracias.
Todo lo que quieran decirle a Juan, saludos, pueden hacerlo. Ya se fue.
If anybody wanted to greet Juan, they could. So we'll see you next Thursday. We're going to share the University of Philadelphia presentation with the Panamanian Association, the Panama Clinic. We're going to have Dr. Daniel Ian, who is one of the authors with Dr. Cayuc. He'll be speaking at 6 p.m. Panamanian time, 7 their time. We're going to talk about reconstructive surgery in the upper urinary tract. So we'll be supporting you with that. No problem. Thank you very much. Good evening. Goodbye. Before I leave, greetings to all our friends from Mexico who were really chatty, Dr. Galicia and all of our colleagues. So thank you very much and good luck. Yes, Mexico supports. Thank you very much. And Dr. Fuya, thank you very much, who has been helping us with the Latin American point of view. I see a lot of Chileans. Dr. Pinto. We also had people from Venezuela.
Hola, Iván, ¿cómo estás?
Te felicito, gran organización, tremendo curso.
Excellent presentations, excellent course. Thank you very much. Varios meses vamos a estar en esto. This is going to be several weeks long. So we're going to tell people in Chile all about it. Thanks so much. Carlos is the mastermind. And a fossa. So thank you very much. Greetings.